Okay, look at this. It's episode 3 of Lunch With.
Oh, cool.
And today we're with Brian Jackson, Brian Anthony, Action Jackson.
Yeah.
And choose your pick.
There's whichever one you want.
I've gigged with all 3 of those guys,
yeah,
so
exactly.
It's cool. But this is the guy who we have referenced in my first 2 episodes, whether it was with Rob or with Sean.
Yeah.
We said, oh, it was Brian Bolivar, or Action Bolivar. So this is the guy. With his new haircut.
New to you, old to me. I haven't seen you in years.
That's right. It's been at least 17, 18 years we've seen.
Months.
Yes. Yeah. It's been a couple of years anyway.
Yeah.
So, let's dig into the deep questions. This will take about 20 minutes. So the first question is silly. Where and when did we meet?
Which is when we were born.
Yeah, pretty much. From birth.
June 3, I don't remember.
Union City. Our families were friends, so we were family friends. I hope you can see everything. So that's about where it was. Okay, yeah, so we've known each other since before we were actually playing. We weren't even playing. We were playing with Army Men and Hot Wheels before we were base.
Your mom would babysit us.
Mm-hmm.
While you were in St. Clements, and my mom went to work, I think.
Something like that, yeah.
I was playing with your cars.
That's right, yeah. And I was at school, he's having fun with my toys.
Right, and then if I left one of your cars out or something like that, you come home and then you beat on me.
Hit him hard.
You've been touching my car.
Reprimanding you strongly.
Yeah, those are my cars.
But then time passes and we start playing guitar and bass and stuff. So how many bands have you and I actually been in together? That's a tough one.
It is. 6? I don't know.
Yeah.
5 to 6 or 8?
Yeah.
Yeah.
Because we did Project AGY.
Right.
With Andy. We did. IOU with Sean. You were in the Taylor Project. You were in The Cue. You were in Waffle Stomper. Bills to Pay, Shark Sandwich. Rolling Blackout, The Fakers, and probably 1 or 2 others.
Yeah, because some of the bands were the same members, we just changed the name, remember?
Mm-hmm. Yep. Waffle Stomper started out when we went down to LA to visit my friend Rosa in Hollywood, and we saw a disco band. Remember that?
Mm-hmm.
It was like the Lava Lounge or something. And that started.
Yeah.
So we'd have to do a disco band. So that was in like 96 or 95, I guess, maybe. 95?
It was more like 98. Maybe. Was that early?
Yeah.
95? Okay.
Mm-hmm. Maybe it's 96. It was right after Bill's Toupee. So we saw this disco band and we said, we have to do that. So we did Waffle Stomper, like 70% disco and then another 40% modern and then another 30%. We're up to about 140% now.
Depending on the night.
Yeah. But no, that was fun. That lasted a long time. Then we just changed the band names, but kept Rob and Mick in there. And that was a good band. We played a lot of gigs.
But then we got really tight together.
Mm-hmm.
So taking on new songs, new arrangements, all that wasn't really a big challenge because we had a flow going.
There was one song we didn't even practice together that we just played at the gig. Do you remember that?
Kind of like Billy Satellite.
We yeah.
Played at the Battle of the Bands.
Walk in.
86.
Just walk in, plug in, and
got
play.
Your parts, right? I got my parts.
Yeah, I
okay.
Got it. Yeah. I think we did like that, was it Morning by Green Day, like that?
Uh-huh.
We didn't even practice it. We all learned it on our own.
Mm-hmm.
And played it. No one even knew. So what is, of all those that we've done, what's one of the more memorable gigs we've done? What do you think?
I'm thinking about that.
Mm-hmm.
I think it's the time we played in San Jose.
Mm.
Remember, you walked up to me and said, you know what, hey, shook my hand, we made it, San Jose. It's like, man, then we... Remember that?
No. What band was that?
It was one of the versions of Waffle Stomper. Me, you, and Robin, and then Nick, and then remember Chris Mattson came out and saw us.
Why not? It's still daylight. Thank you.
Can I just put a fresh point of decaf if you need?
Oh, okay, good. Thanks. Chris Mattson? Hi, Chris. Chris Mattson came out.
Why? When did they come out?
Man, where was that? Was that upstairs?
Uh-huh.
At the Beehive?
Wow.
That's the same place Dimebag Darrell came to see
that's
us.
That's right.
Okay.
wow, man, I really enjoyed that gig, and it kind of was cool because we made it into that market.
Yeah.
It was such a market, but, you know, it was a big thing for
us. Trying to think back then, because yeah, it was probably tough, because we were playing Fremont, maybe other East Bay, like Pleasanton and stuff, Wallaby, but San Jose was like the big thing for us, I guess.
Wow.
Yeah, I totally forgot that. But those Beehive was good.
And actually, one of my favorites, too, was the actual... IOU at the fair. I don't know why, I enjoyed that gig.
The one up in Oakland Hills?
Yeah.
Oh, that was fun with Sean.
The one we videotaped.
Yeah. My buddy Carlos videotaped it, and we have that somewhere.
Tara was there.
Nice. My family was there.
What was her name? From Logan. My friend.
Alina?
Alina was there.
Alina. Alina Patukin, as Mike says. She's a Sharks fan. Anyway, she was cool. Yeah, she was, that's right, her sister.
Yep.
That was fun.
Sean did a great drum solo, I think.
You had your big Olympic and the Ray Cuellar, Brian Anthony bass rig, right? And Matt Ulrich was my roadie. Thanks, Matt.
And thanks for all your hard work.
Yeah, that was a good gig. I liked it. We played Friday night at the Lucas Palooza at Rob's place, and then Saturday at the Santa Clara Fair. Two days in a row.
That's right.
That was fun because we didn't have to haul a PA either one. Yeah, I think maybe Paul Camacho and those guys gave us that Santa Clara gig, which was very nice.
Good days.
Yeah. Okay. So on the opposite side of the coin, what was the worst gig we've done? Do you remember anything about a worst gig?
I think we'll have to go with Sean on this one and say the baseball field, whatever, when it was raining or something, right?
They had planned a battle of the bands at the baseball field up on Highway 13, and four people showed up, not including the two bands. It was two bands and four people. And just nobody was there. There was no promotion. There was no PA.
I think Sean's riser was the pitcher's mound.
Yeah.
Something like that, right?
It was something like that, yeah. And it was raining, and I think that was the same time that the kid in the, his name was Sean, also had the Volkswagen van, and he rolled on Sean's foot. I don't know if you remember that, but anyway. Do you remember a gig in Vallejo at a bowling alley with the Taylor Project? Were you playing with us that night? That was awful. And it was, at the time, I didn't know who to blame for such an awful gig, but it was probably just the venue. It wasn't anybody in the band. Right. Or the booker. This was just the venue. It was awful. We were playing in a bowling alley in a room off to the side, and no one came in to see us.
Mm-hmm.
And we had lights and PA and everything. Nobody came in.
Maybe they thought we were like quarantined or something.
Yeah, yeah. Like, yeah, can't go there. Waiting for the sheriff to show up for them. Yeah. So those two were pretty bad, yeah. Then, so we did a lot of recording, demos, albums, whatever. We did a recording, speaking of Elena and Sean, we did a recording in my garage on reel-to-reel of two of her originals.
I was going to say it's one of my favorite experiences
doing that?
As far as playing together when we made that reel-to-reel.
And
those songs.
We did IOU stuff and we did her two songs. And it was like you have to do it three or four times to make sure you have the volumes right and the mics in the right place.
Right.
And then once you get that right, then you just do a bunch of songs. That was fun.
It was.
And that stuff still exists. We did a party at my cousin's house, Ronnie and Dan.
My alembic, and the pickup was loose. It was banging against the string.
Alan Murchison, Lane Murchison, such a fun drummer to play with.
Uh-huh.
Yeah. So recording, we did a lot of Waffle Stomper demo stuff, and Bombstone, Zombie Heart at my house.
That was one of my favorites when you and I would sit in your control room, and we were kind of inspiringly coaching me along with my bass parts,
mm-hmm,
and that stuff for that album.
And you doing that with me.
Uh-huh.
There's little video camera clips, I think my nephew Dan did, of me playing and you engineering and coaxing the part out of me. I have to take a step aside one time here. So one night I was doing a gig with a band, Would I? Good guys. So I was a little overzealous, and you came to watch. You drove up with me to the gig in Danville, and we're on the second song. And it's like there's, 15, 20 people in the club. It's pretty cool. We're on the second song, and I'm cooking.
Uh-huh.
And you looked up at me and said, slow down. because I was like way ahead of the guy. And I pulled back, you know, and then you went, okay.
Right. Too much coffee or something.
It had to be. Yeah. It was exciting. Yeah. Thank you. Okay, back to recording.
I was going to say, because some of those parts that I had on that album, some of the best bass parts I've ever written. Because I remember you guys had given me the recordings, and I just sat in my front room. I don't know, it just flowed out.
The zombie awesome. Heart stuff, right?
Yeah. Mm-hmm. But it's fantastic.
What time? Second time? What's the second to last? Last song on the album.
Can we just
have a
drink?
Rob, I can't remember the name of your song. Something Time. Fighting Time.
Yeah, Fighting Time.
Fighting Time. Man, that bass part on there with you and Steve.
Yeah,
man. That's
what I'm saying. And working with him, like listening to him, mm-hmm. is inspirational mm-hmm. as well. It really makes you strive to write better parts when you have that drummer.
And you can, and as long as he's a guy you can sink your teeth into, too, yes.
Some chemistry there, you know, you can just feel it. But it's like makes you want to play better to match that part.
Yeah, exactly. Yeah, and you did. Mm-hmm. Do you remember doing a live recording session at Phyllis's house up in Concord,
mm-hmm.
where I think my guitar amp was in the bathroom, and Jerry was over by the TV, and Ray was by the fireplace, and it worked. I don't remember how it sounded.
Whatever we were doing, it sounded good.
Everything's mic'd up. There's cables everywhere throughout the whole house, and we're all in communication with headphones and microphones, and you hear the click, and you start playing. That was fun. Because Ray and Jerry were fun to try to keep up with, for me anyway. They're just, you know, they're that. Wow. So we did all the recording. Are there any things that we did that you kind of wish you had recording of?
I'm not going to eat my food right when you're asking me. Not when I answer, I spit mashed potatoes out at you.
Oh, we'll have video of that, no problem. Yeah.
What was the question?
Are there any gigs that you wish you had a recording of, audio or video or both? Or?
I remember there was one night at the Huddle, one of our nights there, right? And I'm like playing. It's one of those nights where it's like this in anything, like even sports or a gig, when everything you're doing works.
Yeah. Yeah,
and I was all over the place. I think I had my music band, the orange one, you know, that
mm-hmm.
the orange stinger.
Yes.
And everything I was doing was freaking good. Right? All over the place. Just the mind of
delicious.
Good.
Thank you very much.
She's not getting paid for this.
We're going to do a dine and dash.
Only me? Okay. No, I'm talking about for the video.
Oh, no, she's not. No, we're not going to dine and dash. No, she's not getting a residual or nothing. No.
Just me.
Yeah. Well, if you ask me, it's like you and Mickey and even Rob were always on. I mean, I can't even remember a night where you guys were messing up. But you guys were always on. But you know when you were smoking.
Yeah.
There was when we were playing at Feltz, I think, in San Juan.
Oh, yeah.
And I didn't record that night. And I used to record a lot of the gigs. And we went into this, I remember, we went into this one jam between songs. And you guys were just hitting so hard and so solid. And I pulled up this weird tone on the Octavia thing, and it almost sounded like steel drums. And I'm doing this really cool pattern in my head. It was cool.
Mm-hmm.
And it just went into the air, and we never recorded that night. And so there are a few things in there, but yeah, the Huddle.
Wish it was recorded somewhere.
And where we're sitting right now is about half a mile from the Huddle. Believe it or not, if you could geotag us, whatever.
Yeah. Stone's throw.
Yeah, Huddle's right there. And we used to...
Let's go over there after this.
Yeah, let's go hang out, have a couple beers with Beto. Right when you're drinking. It was cool.
That was clean, because sometimes in the past, when you made me laugh, it goes all over the place.
Now, we used to go to Caro's. After gigs a lot.
One time there were some law enforcement officers also dining in the dining room.
Yeah, that was
we went to some of California's finest.
Yeah. We went to like Pumas or something to see a band, and we don't do any illicit things, during or after gigs or before. We were just goofy, and we were at a restaurant in San Jose. dying laughing. And there were two CHPs living four or five tables over, kind of like keeping an eye on us.
Watching.
But it was one of those.
To see if any alcohol on the tables.
Yeah, anything, yeah. And it was one of those where I was laughing so hard I fell on the bench. I just couldn't, you know. And the stomach hurts. Yeah. That was fun stuff.
It is. I don't think they followed us, right? Thinking we were
no.
Talking. Nothing like that. But
there was one time we were in L.A. You and we were drunk because we had gone to like the whiskey or the rocks. One of those, you know, one of those Hollywood clubs. And we were at an IHOP. I went in to use the restroom. And there was a cop at the next stall over. I started talking to him.
Hey, having a good time?
Yeah, I was having a good time. I said, man, we're having a great time, and we're not driving. So I had to explain it to him. I don't know why, but it was funny.
We're not driving.
So Brandon and I have not only done gigs together and hung out together, we've gone on vacation. We've done fireworks together. All that fun stuff, but this is
same and same.
Same and same. So, but this is just kind of concentrating on our music.
We digress.
Yeah. Oh. So the next question is, coincidentally, have we ever gone to gigs together, to shows together?
No, I think once.
Yeah. It was like a spoken word poetry thing.
Yeah,
right?
I remember it started way back. You kind of took me under your wing. You were very generous.
I was way older too.
Yeah, way older. My mentor, and this is when you had the Chevelle, and we went to see Eddie Money's guitar player,
Jimmy Lyon.
Oh,
in Haywood, on Main Street.
Yep.
Oh man,
great kid, man. I think it was one of the first that you like introducing me to. It opened my eyes.
Was that? This might be weird, but was that the same day that we were jamming in your front room with Frank? Maybe. Could it have been? It could have been. I just have feeling. I just had that. Yeah, memory.
I just know that. When you knew I took up the bass,
oh, yeah.
That was kind of the thing we did. It's like, let me take you to some gigs.
I'll show you how it's done. Yeah,
it's done.
Cool.
Right? Locally, in
Vancouver. I didn't realize.
It was one of the first that I saw, with your first ever that I saw. Because it was under 21.
Yeah, yeah, yeah. And it was like Saturday night, 8 to 10, or 8 to 11. $4 to get in, probably. That's cool. I didn't realize you remember that.
That's cool. And then we've also done some jazz fusion gigs.
We saw, was that with you when we saw Leave It Now?
Yeah,
at the Greek, for one, with Abe playing bass and Carlos Vega. And did we see Larry Carlton in San Jose or in Saratoga? What's that place? Remember that place you played, Saratoga, next to Harry's House of Hanging Meat? That it was a Hofbrauer's home. The cabaret.
Yeah.
We saw Larry Carlton at the cabaret.
So there you go, with Marshall.
Yeah. Many times. I've got a couple of videos of him playing with Marshall. They're a good band.
Wow.
Man, see, this could be like a 2-hour episode, really. It's already hitting like a half hour.
We need more than the allotted time. 32 minutes.
Yeah.
It's not going to work.
Why video online YouTube that they have limits. So,
yeah.
But tell the story if you will. Anyway, tell the story if you could about.
You've been watching too much Mike Douglas.
Yeah. Later on we'll have Ross Tompkins in the band. When we did play that one in Oakland Hills with Sean. That day I had to come to your house to pick you and your gear up so we could drive up in my community. Tell that story.
I was going to say you and your girl up by that.
No,
girl
no.
Back there.
No. And tell that story about how I came back in your backyard.
Oh, that was so great. Yeah, because from what I was saying, you kind of showed up, right? I ran out front and you had your El Camino.
El Camino.
Those cool wheels on it. I love the color. The two-tone, right?
Mm-hmm.
And then... Because the gear was way in the backyard in the spare garage, right? So you went backwards up the driveway, and I ran into one of our rooms that was on the side there, and I'm looking down, I hear this, here's Tom, he's flying by backwards going into my backyard, man, just without hesitation, no stopping, straight down. Stops right at the end. I run out and then start loading the gear, man. The sun was out, the bushes, it was just a picture of perfect.
And just backing up fast and in your backyard. It was easy, I guess.
Straight as an arrow. Like you're a stunt driver.
I was back then, yeah. I gave that up, though.
But I remember that. It's crystal clear.
Yeah, that's why I wanted to say it, yeah. I remember, too. I remember we loaded up and jet it out the wheel. It was fun. See, we've done gigs for like 35 years together, man.
Hundreds, maybe a thousand.
Well, if you figured guess, how many gigs do you think we've done? 500 or 600 together, that's my guess. I'd say 600 gigs together. Because if you figure, sometimes it was two a weekend, and we played, I don't know, sometimes 30 weekends in a year, 35 weekends in a year maybe. So, and then it slowed down a little.
Then we had some weeknights with the queue as well, right?
Yes.
Weeknights in the...
Oh, in Santa Clara? Yeah. We played, they called us one night last minute to play Thanksgiving. McNeil's or McNear's or whatever it was called. And we just, we got on the phones with everybody because that's what you did. You had to call from your home phone. And you want to do it? Yeah, I'll be there at 8. Okay. And we all went, and remember Kelly Booth brought food? And there was food set up for Thanksgiving for the people that were at the bar that didn't have a family.
Back then, if you didn't answer your home phone, you never got the gig.
Yes, you had to answer your home phone, yeah. But I remember Ray had a pager because he wanted to be in touch, which is cool. Plus, we have a kid.
He had the pager or something else, but we don't.
We don't. Yeah. Yep.
Good day.
Yeah, weeknight gigs, man. Fun.
Yeah.
The last question.
Are we at the end?
I think so, because have we been to shows together? That was, we've been to tons of shows. We've seen so many bands.
Right.
The one I regret, Sean, is we were gigging when Dan Reed Network was playing at the Stone, and we had a gig that night. And Sean went, he said it was great.
That's right. Thanks, Sean.
We missed it. That was one gig.
He says he went. I don't have proof that he actually went. He's just rubbing it in.
Yeah.
On one of those nights we were gigging to, Glenn Hughes was playing.
Really?
Remember in San Francisco? Or one of the gigs that he had.
Mm-hmm. I remember we were playing when Larry Carlton was at the Circle Star, I think.
Oh, yeah.
Missed that.
Yeah.
But just for as many as we missed, there's tons we went to. We even went to see local bands just to get ideas of what to do. Sometimes we'd go to Boswell's, we'd go to the Huddle.
Of course.
That's what you do when you're a musician, I guess.
Yes. And the Battle of the Bands.
So many battles, yeah.
Back in the 80s and 90s, right? Mostly 80s.
I tried out for the battle once when I was in high school, right after high school, and I just was a spectator from then on. And it's like, yeah.
Well, of course, I played one of the Battle of the Bands.
That's right. One or two, one? With Rob and Dave. Dave Guadarrama, where are you, man? Oh, sorry.
I hope so. I want to hear what he has, some of his memories.
Yeah.
And Jens.
I saved $1,000.
And Sean.
Chime in, yeah. That was a great gig. I don't remember much of it, because it happened so fast.
Yeah. It's like 12 songs, or 3 songs, 12 minutes, and you're done. It's like, yeah, it screams by, yeah.
All your stuff is off to the side, kind of preset. Just get it out really fast, plug it in. And Jens couldn't get his keyboards to work. So I think he ran over and used Rob's keyboards because his whole setup sat empty for the whole gig.
Funny, how funny.
Wow. Nobody was there. Yeah.
That's hilarious. I was taking pictures, I think, of my action heroes.
That's when I had my mullet.
Who didn't?
We could do a whole session just about my mullet.
We could. 20 minutes, easy.
That's too long.
We could do a photo montage.
Yeah. Nice. I got a perm, but I don't want to get into that. I've always said too much.
We can edit. We can strike that from the...
Strike. Well, we might not want to.
No.
It's let people know. I got a perm. Right? And I'm okay with that. You know?
Have you come to terms with it?
In 87, everybody was doing it, okay?
Don't judge me, man. Yeah, we won't strike that. We'll leave that raw and accurate.
Yeah, unedited.
So, besides me, what musicians do we have as favorites in common?
I thought about it. Oh, shoot.
Yeah.
Where do we start?
I know. There's jazz, there's fusion, there's rock, there's some metal that I almost kind of like.
Folk,
sure.
David Soul.
There you go.
Mac.
Don't give up on us, baby.
Mac Davis.
Yeah. Oh, yeah. No, but I mean, you know, he turned me on to a lot of fusion that I didn't even know about, which is cool.
It's rock. Because you're listening to it now.
Mm-hmm.
When I was listening to it in 84.
Yeah, like, exactly. Julie, you know? I just bought Billy Cobham like 3 months ago, and he's like, I knew that one in 1979 or whatever it was. Yeah. So it's cool.
And, but we turned it forever.
and Olivia's stuff with Carlos and Landau and the entire stuff, Larry.
Yeah.
All that stuff. So that to say what bands people call Huge Thrall and Dan Reed Network were big when, and Enough's Enough were big when we were driving 2 hours to gigs. We would
We
have to listen to something that motivates you to get there, to battle the traffic and the heat sometimes, and to keep you up and excited about music by the time you get to the gig after a 2 hour drive, like to Ukiah or Clear Lake.
Right.
So we listened to this upbeat Vane, the first album.
Oh, ready to play. Three of these comments.
You get there and you're ready. Even Faith No More we listened to one time on the way to Ukiah.
Some of those rock stuff, like rock stuff from the 80s, and the good stuff, Winger.
Yeah, I remember Winger. He always liked Winger.
Always.
He always liked Winger.
Yeah.
Yeah. But I remember Steve, our buddy Steve, found, I think, Dan Reed Network, The Heat. I think that's their second album.
Is that right? Yeah, The Heat.
And I had to calculate in my mind how long it's going to take to put it onto cassette. So that it'll be ready to go by the time we leave for the gig that night, because he gave it to me on Friday after work. He found it and said, I'm buying this for Tom.
Yeah.
I sure hope this is recording, because we're doing some good stuff here.
We can always go back and do it over.
We could. We can schedule another lunch.
It's all scripted. I'm looking at it. So we go back.
We're not going to use auto-tune on this either.
No.
But yeah, we listen to it with you. I remember, one other thing about the music we liked, and I'm an Enough's Enough fan. I think that's a great combination of hard rock, Cheap Trick, and Beatles. I think that's what it is to me. I don't know if we planned it or what, but we would always have like two or three albums ready to go on cassette for the drive. And one night we pulled into Wayzata in Clear Lake, and we parked just as Time to Let You Go finished at the end of the Enough's Enough. Whatever album that is, String Time. We stopped the car and the song ended. And then I turned off the ignition.
And we jumped out, unloaded the gear,
and
rock hard.
We're not going to get into the time that everyone bought me a couple of rum and cokes.
If you want.
No.
Let's just say it was fun.
It was, and let's also just say that he knows how to help a friend who has long, long hair. When that inevitable time in the bathroom happens, and you just hold the hair back.
Visit the restroom.
Yeah, you hold the hair back. Yeah, so thank you for that.
You're welcome.
We've done that a few times where we had a little too much fun, but you know. Not as many as some.
Always safely done, though.
Yeah. Like that night, Ray drove, I didn't drive.
Yeah, of course.
Yeah.
Never to extreme excess, always safely.
One more thing about Ray Merlin. That next day, he kind of took me under his wing and said,
"That's my guitar player."
Yeah, and he got me, a Coke, just to get me through, you know. And he goes, and I remember, I'll say this, I hope he gets a kick out of this because I remember it. He goes, "You don't have to drink again tonight, but don't swear at all."
Exactly.
I said, "Okay, yeah, he's right." Yeah. It was funny.
I got one word for you, Nielsen Pearson.
Yes, that album. I found that at the warehouse in San Lorenzo.
Man.
Just because I saw the names of the players on the back.
Yeah. I was listening to that on YouTube a couple 3 months ago, and still, the thing holds up.
It does, yeah.
So at least in my mind. It's enjoyable. The arrangements, the tones, the songwriting.
Everything. The playing is top notch. Yeah,
that's what I'm there you go. Just because that's kind of in
music we haven't come
to. Stuff that we haven't come to, that you introduced me to.
Yeah. So with this in mind, it's like our food is almost done and we're running out of time. The sponsors are giving me the sign to, you know, cut. So with that in mind, we'll do another episode one day in a couple months, few months, about other things we didn't cover this time.
Right. And I hope to keep contributing to these questions through our experiences because we're still playing together, right?
We still have
work to do. We're not stopping just because I've moved.
Right, we have an album to record.
Yes.
Sorry.
Yeah, I've been more gigs to go to, more parts to record, more.
And if you and Jeannie decide to come back to California or the Bay Area in specific, that would be even funner.
That's going to be great.
Because all I got to do is get up for work on Monday morning. Other than that,
right,
I'm free.
If we're in the Sacramento area, you just drive up.
I'd visit Terry. And he's like, it's like a 2-hour drive to visit Terry. It's no big deal.
Drive your El Camino right up there.
Get the shell on it now, you know.
It's good in case it's raining.
A Sacramento trip is no big deal. Yeah. I've done that a few times and it's fun and it's totally worth the drive.
Right.
Okay, so are we good?
We are. Thanks for having me.
Right on, man. Thank you for being part of my show, my third episode. And there will be more in the future with other folks. You know who you are. And I sure hope this came out good because we're here. I didn't even mention where we are. We're at the Country Way in Fremont. Like, you know, right off of 880.
Where else would we go?
Right, right.
When I visit.
We've had lots of foods here. Fun times.
Yep.
Okay. Thanks for watching. Thanks for being here, man.
Thank you.
That's what the kids do.
Fantastic.
Yeah. And we're done.
All right. Thank you.
Bye.